Hey everyone, a very good morning to all of you. Myself, Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs. I welcome you all in this video, which is going to be useful for your RBI-SET NAMAD examination. So let's begin this video. But before that, if you are a newcomer and you have not subscribed to our channel till now, then do not forget to subscribe and hit the bell notification. Also, you can join this Telegram group and the link of this is in description below. Now, on this group, you can enjoy the free quizzes that we provide and also you can directly connect with your mentors. So if you want to ask something, then you can just ask us on this Telegram group. This is the new course for RBI Grade 3 2022, in which we'll get PDFs, videos and mocks along with the mock interviews. Here you will also get a content kit that will include all the books that are mentioned here in this slide. Along with this, right now we are running a 30% discount on this course, which you can avail by using RBI 30 coupon code. And if you have any queries related to the course, then you can just call us on this number. Okay, so that was all. Now let's begin the first question. Who is the president of Indian Broadcasting Foundation? R.K. Dhawan, Sanjay Pandey, Anita Patel, K. Madhavan, Gyan Bhushan. Out of these five options, the right answer is option B. K. Madhavan is the present president of Indian Broadcasting Foundation. Now, why is this IBF in the news? The reason behind this is that this foundation is going to change its name to Indian Broadcasting Digital Foundation. Now, with the change of its name comes the extra work, extra responsibility. And what is the extra responsibility? Basically, the scope of this Indian Broadcasting Foundation is being expanded. And digital content providers will also come under this Indian Broadcasting Foundation. That means all the content provided by the OTT platforms, the over-the-top platforms, will now be regulated by this Indian Broadcasting Foundation. Now, what is the meaning of OTT platforms? OTT platforms refer to platforms like Netflix, Amazon, and Amazon Prime, and all such kinds of platforms that provide you with the content digital. Okay. Now, these channels will be regulated by IBBF. That is why it was in the news, and it is your responsibility to know that who is the president of this organization. Now, apart from this, there was a major announcement made by this Indian Broadcasting Foundation, and that announcement is that this IBDF, basically Indian Broadcasting Foundation and IBDF, is the same organization. IBDF is the new name of this organization, so remember this. So this IBDF has announced that it is going to create a self-regulatory organization, and that organization will be named as Digital Content Regulatory Council, Digital Media Content Regulatory Council. That would be the name of the new self-regulatory organization that will be conducted, that will be developed by this IBDF. So I hope that this question is clear to you now. And let's move on to the next question. Guys, this question is important because it is about the new scheme, YUVA, that has been launched by Prime Minister. So do listen to me very carefully till the end of this question. And also the question that I'm going to discuss later on are equally important. So do not leave the video in the middle after listening to this question just. Okay, so let's discuss this question. How much financial assistance will be provided to the authors selected under the YUVA scheme for 6 months? Now, what is this YUVA scheme all about? That we will be discussing a little later. But first, let's know how much financial assistance will be provided to the authors under this YUVA scheme. So out of these many amounts, the right answer here is option C. That is rupees 50,000 per month scholarship will be provided to the authors that are going to be selected under this YUVA scheme. Now you should also know that a total number of 75 authors will be selected under this scheme. Now what is the scheme all about? First, let's begin with the full form of YUVA. So YUVA stands for Young, Upcoming and Versatile Authors. So this is the new scheme. And what is the purpose of launching this scheme? The purpose is basically to train the authors who are below the age of 30. So remember, 30 years is the eligibility of this scheme, which can become a question in your upcoming examination. So do not forget, 30 years is the eligibility. So in order to train the authors who are below the age of 30 or up to 30 years, this scheme has been launched. Now, what is the purpose of training them? The purpose is to create a stream, a group of authors that can write on Indian culture, Indian heritage and Indian history. And by doing so, they will be presenting India as well as Indian culture to the world. So that is the purpose of launching YUVA scheme. I'm repeating myself that it is to create a group of authors who can write on Indian culture, heritage and history. And that will be a way through for India to the world. So that will be presenting India to the world. Okay. And under this YUVA scheme, you should remember this thing, that it is 50,000 per month will be provided to the authors. Total number of authors that will be selected will be 75. And this financial assistance will be provided for 6 months. Okay, so these were some facts related to YUVA scheme. I hope that you have understood the basic purpose for launching this YUVA scheme. Now remember that National Book Trust, NBT India, is the implementing agency of this scheme. And this NBT India is going to publish the books that these authors are going to write after the books get completed. Okay, so that was another fact related to this news, that NBT India, National Book Trust India, is the implementing agency of this scheme. So this is the picture. I hope that it helps you in memorizing the facts better. So remember that YUVA scheme has been launched on the occasion of Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav 2022. You would know this Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav, as we are going to celebrate our 75th anniversary of Indian independence. So in order to celebrate the 75th anniversary in 2022, Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav has been launched and it is in place since March onwards. Okay. So these are the highlights of this YUVA scheme. as you can see. The first point is the purpose, that to mentor the budding young writers below 30 years of age. The second is the theme. Now, what are the themes that these writers are going to write on? The themes are like unsung heroes of freedom fighters, national movement, independence, Indian history. All the topics related to Indian history, Indian heritage and Indian culture are going to become the theme of this scheme, okay, on which the writers are expected to write on. Selection through All India Contest, and this is not an important point for us. The contest period will be from 1st June to 31st July. This is again not important. Total 75 authors will be selected. This is important. Selected authors will be announced on 15th August 2021. Okay, this year on Independence Day, the people who are going to be selected will be announced. And the winner entries will be published on 15th December 2021. So basically, the entries or the written pieces that were selected will be published by 15th December 2021. And published books will be launched on 12th January 2022. That is Yuva Divas, National Youth Day. On that day, all the books will be published, the books that are prepared under this Yuva scheme. And scholarship is 50,000 per month for a period of 6 months. So that we have already discussed. Now, if you have any problem regarding understanding this scheme, then you can just message us on the Telegram group or in the comment section. Okay, moving on to the next question. Who is the convener of the 7-member panel of state ministers set up by GOI, Government of India, for better valuation of services of casinos, online gaming platform and race courses for levying GST, goods and services tax? So basically, a panel of state ministers has been created that is going to evaluate the valuation of services provided by casinos, online gaming platforms and race courses. And also, this panel is going to examine the method of valuation, the method of calculating the value of services provided by these different platforms. Okay, understood. So who is the convener of this group? So we have Madan Lal, Fakhri Alam, Vibhuti Bhushan Das, Nitin Patel, Santosh Chilpurkar. Out of these options, the right answer is option B. That is Nitin Patel. Now, Nitin Patel is at present the Deputy Chief Minister of Gujarat. Remember this fact as well. As I have told you that this panel is going to evaluate the method of valuation as well. So, do remember the same method of valuation as well as the evaluation of the value of the services provided by these different platforms. Now, right now, how much GST is levied on these services? At present, it is 18%. Remember that as well. So, 18% GST is levied on the services provided by casinos, online gaming platforms as well as resources. Understood? So let's move on to the next question. Who has recorded the world's fastest ascent of Everest by a woman with a time of just 25 hours and 50 minutes? So basically, this question is asking the fastest ascent by a woman. So who has recorded that PR under her name? Who is that person? It is option A, Sang Yin Hoon. And she belongs to Hong Kong, remember. She is from Hong Kong. Now, who is that person? This is Sang Yin Hoon. But who is this person? This person is Arthur Mule. And he is from America. And he also created a record and he became the oldest American to summit the Mount Everest. Okay, so that was his record. He is at present around 75 years and he climbed the Mount Everest summit and he became the oldest American to do so. So these were the two records made by these two people. Okay, so this is our last question. How much amount is RBI transferring to the central government for 2020-2021 as per its annual report? The right answer here is option B, ₹99,122 crores. Remember that for the upcoming year, that is 2021 to 2022, RBI has already announced that it is going to provide 50,000 crores to the central government. So the surplus of rupees 50,000 crores will be transferred to the central government. Now we are talking about the transfer of surplus money from RBI to the central government. I hope that this triggers your memory, and if you go down your memory lane, then you would remember Bimal Jalan committee recommendations as well, which are very important for your examination. So do cover all the Bimal Jalan committee recommendations on the transfer of surplus money from RBI to the central government. And remember that the recommendations of Bimal Jalan committee was covered on our YouTube channel. So if you want to get help in covering those recommendations, then you can just scroll down the channel and watch that video as well. Okay, I'm going to ask you a question here, and the question is that when was this committee formed? This is your question for the day that you have to answer in the comment section below. Okay, now as I mentioned here in the question that it is the annual report for 2020 to 2021, so let's discuss the facts provided by this report. The first dimension that this report takes into consideration is the foreign exchange. So in the year FY21, the foreign exchange gains rose from 29,000 to 50,000 crores. So this is a tremendous increase in the foreign exchange reserves of India. And remember that USA has also put India on its watch list of currency manipulators. So this might trigger your thinking capability that why is India has been put on that list, because of its tremendous increase in the foreign exchange transactions. Okay. Next point is rupee against dollar. That is how much rupee has strengthened against the dollar. So rupee has strengthened by 3.5% against the US dollar at the end of March 2021. as compared to the amount in March 2020. However, Indian rupee underperformed in comparison to other Asian countries. Now, this is not a very important point that you can remember because Indian rupee is very much volatile. Therefore, this is not very important for us to remember. Okay. So, the next point is surplus transfer to the government. So, RBI is going to transfer this much amount in FY21. We have already discussed. Now, here important point is that Section 47 of RBI Act 1934 allows this transfer of surplus money to the central government after deduction of all the necessary expenses. And remember that for the upcoming year, that is FY22, 50,000 crore is going to be transferred from RBI to the central government. And this point is important that RBI has changed its accounting year to April to March, from July to June. So that was about this surplus to the government. Next point is the decrease in the banking frauds. Now all these statements are here just the ratios that you have to mug up because there is nothing much that you can remember. Bank frauds of rupees 1 lakh or more fell by 25% in value to rupees 1.38 trillion in 2020-2021, and the number of cases declined by 15%. And apart from this, gross NPL ratio of banks decreased to 6.8% in December 2020. Provision coverage ratio has also improved to 75.5%. Capital to risk coverage ratio also improved to 15.9%. Then we have gross NPL ratio of NBFCs, which improved to 5.7% in December, and capital adequacy ratio of NBFC, which improved to 24.8%. So these are just the ratios that you have to pay attention to. Next point is, next dimension here is digital payments. So total digital transaction volume increased to 4,371 crore as against the 3,412 crore in FY20. And this is basically due to the COVID-19 pandemic. And the initiatives taken by RBI to promote digital infrastructure payment is Innovation Hub. RBI has created the Innovation Hub and we have already discussed the new CEO appointed for this Innovation Hub. Now you have to tell me the name of that person. Okay, the next initiative is Regulatory Sandbox, and then extending the geotagging framework so that the exact location of payments can be tracked. Next is steps for boosting liquidity. So you must have covered this GSEC acquisition program that was launched by RBI to acquire the government securities. Then accommodative stance that RBI is continually maintaining and the lower monetary policy rates. And GDP forecast is the same 10.5% that RBI has forecasted earlier. So that was all for today. I hope that you have enjoyed the video and thank you so much for watching the video.